May I ask you a question? What do you think of me?
What do you mean?
You've known me nearly all your life. You must have formed some opinion of me.
Well, I always thought that you were a very nice person.
Did you know I was an alcoholic?
What?
Did you know that?
Look, I think I should be going.
Sit down, Benjamin.
Mrs. Robinson, if you don't mind my saying so, this conversation is getting a little strange.
Hello, darkness, my old friend. I've come to talk with you again. Because a vision softly creeping left its seeds while I was sleeping.
The proper way to eat a fig in society is to split it in four, holding it by the stump, and open it, so that it is a glittering, rosy, moist, honeyed, heavy-petaled, four-petaled flower.
You know I always believe in love. But where do you find it nowadays?
Then you throw away the skin after you have taken off the blossom with your lips.
She was a nuisance. Not for a minute would she keep still. Not until I'd slapped her hard and made her cry.
My God, when I think of you and your world, it makes my heart sick. You're so limited, you're a dead end. You cannot love.
And you?
I could never love you.
You can't bear anything to be spontaneous, can you?
It was a horrible creature, sir, with huge eyes, sir. Oh, with the wings, sir. Oh, let me alone.
From this old house, some evil thing was spawned to bring terror to the surrounding countryside. What was Professor Malinger's gruesome secret? And how was his beautiful daughter involved?
Look at that moon.
The Blood Beast Terror. Peter Cushing, Robert Fleming, Wanda Ventum, guest star Roy Hudd.
Hello everyone, Kevin Markwick here again. Welcome along to the latest edition of the new lockdown podcast. It quickly became apparent last week that me droning on like a simple-minded horse wasn't the most interesting podcast in the world. So what I thought I'd do to zizz it up a bit would be to go out and find some guests who like to talk about movies, and we'll tie it into particular weeks or a couple of weeks here and there. We've been reasonably fluid, actually, to be honest, rather than specifically matching the date. Just talk about cinema and our love of cinema and the love of the movies and why they picked these particular movies. And I've got myself some very nice guests lined up over the next few weeks. Hopefully you'll enjoy it too. And for this very first edition with a guest, I have someone very special, Francine Stock, who I first met some years ago when I went on to the film programme on Radio 4. She's a broadcaster, critic, writer. She's hosted Newsnight, Front Row, the film programme. Which she's presented actually since 2004. She's stepped back a little bit now and is doing some rather interesting interviews with filmmakers and how certain films have been influences on them. And I can highly recommend you go and have a listen to that as well. It's on the film programme website on Radio 4. She's also a writer. Her published work includes two novels, short stories, film criticism, and as well as a study of cultural and political influence of cinema in glorious technicolor, a century of film and how it shaped us, which I can also recommend, and I have a very precious signed copy of that one. She's been a judge on the Booker Prize and guest artistic director from the of the From Page to Screen Festival, chair of the Tate members from 2005 to 2010, and she recently presented Tate's first live gallery to cinema relay, Matisse Live, which was very successful. She's on the British Council Arts Advisory Board, a director of the Hay Festival of Literature, a patron of Borderlines Film Festival, and an honorary fellow of Jesus College, Oxford. So, the theme you will find here is that everybody who's on here is way smarter than me. So that's why I love to talk to them, because they're so interesting and so wonderful. What we talked about was actually 1970. and Francine had picked out the week beginning June the 7th and the week beginning June the 14th. What I did actually is I sent them whole, everybody that has brilliantly agreed to appear on the show, a grid of everything that we shown over April, May and June at the Picture House in Uckfield since we arrived here in 1964. So it's a pretty big grid of stuff to choose from. Anyway, here's Francine and I having a nice chat.
Why is it that we usually ignore the fourth dimension? You see, we can move in the other three. As the doctor said, up, down, forwards, backwards, sideways. But when it comes to time, we are prisoners.
Hey, Doc, we better back up. We don't have enough road to get up to 88.
Roads? Where we're going, we don't need roads.
You maniac! You blew it up! God damn you! God damn you all to hell!
Must be some kind of hot tub time machine.
Things will change slightly, but we'll find a way through because people are too ingenious. They don't want to give up on the things they love doing. They'll find a way.
Well, actually, interestingly, Pearl and Dean did a, I don't know if you saw that, not the famous singing duo, the cinema advertising.
No, I know. Those people.
Yeah, all that. And they did a survey last week and asked people what the thing they're most looking forward to, what they're going to do first when they get released. And top of the list came haircuts and beauty therapy. And second was restaurants and cinemas. Just this idea of going, I mean, maybe nostalgia. Is nostalgia a good thing to be promoting at this point?
Well, what do we do? We can call it sort of, it's like excavating memories rather than nostalgia. I mean, it's not necessarily saying it's better. Just saying it's very vivid, isn't it? I think
it's kind of vivid and very different, I think, as well. And I mean, how much my memories and, or I don't know, I mean, cinema does seem to set a thing up in people's minds. People are very keen to talk about cinema. They're very keen to talk about, because they set memories off, don't they,
They're early. Going to the cinema is often an early family experience, isn't it? When you remember having everybody around you. You can usually remember big things like birthdays and Christmases and all that, but they're more diffuse. Whereas the going to the cinema is a few hours together. You all go, there's a sense of, well, there was a sense of occasion. There still can be, I think. And I'm trying to remember my first, I think, we went to live in Australia when I was six. And I remember going to a huge cinema in Melbourne. You know, Melbourne has lots of Victorian architecture, so there was lots of, from the early 20th century, a lot of architecture from there, and going to a very grand cinema and going to see My Fair Lady.
And that would have been in sort of 60...
What is My Fair Lady? 64? Oh, God,
yeah, it's around that time, but that doesn't necessarily mean that's when it played.
Of course, a lot of it sort of passed me by, but the sheer spectacle and that opening sequence, which actually is shot by somebody else, isn't it? It's shot by Cukor or somewhere, of the flowers opening, that sort of time thing. And that completely blew my mind. So...
It's interesting. That's interesting, because that sort of ties in with... the sort of size of cinema, particularly when you're a child, isn't it? That's what you find overwhelming. The two experiences I had like that were, unfortunately, I never had the experience much of going to the cinema as a family.
Of course not.
Because I was in it. I grew up in it. So, you know, my father, very, very rarely did we ever go to the cinema together. And one of the first times, in fact, I can only think of two times in my life where we went to another cinema as a family. And the first one was a very sort of similar experience. We went to see Paint Your Wagon in 70mm at the Elder Storia in Brighton, which was the big 70mm cinema. So I'm guessing your My Fair Lady experience was also probably in 70mm as well.
Does that look fantastic? Possibly. And everything about it was just too super real. And that was just wonderful. And of course, I then dressed up. I recreated all the scenes then over the next few months at home with things from the dressing up box.
Yeah, Yeah, I don't think I'd dress as Clint Eastwood or Lee Marvin. I used to play Where Eagles Dare in the garden. Yeah. That was my that was my thing. But no, that's quite, so that's, you know, I think this is why I like the interfilm thing that we do, or previously the you know, and kids just coming to the cinema for nothing in the mornings out of school time. And because I think, you know, once they, I think once we've got them, then we've got, you know, you've got them for life, haven't you? I think
you know, recent statistics would show that actually people go on going, you know, even though they have all their home entertainment options. Obviously slightly different at the moment, but even so.
Yeah, that's the thing. And people always say that, to, you know, if I get in a cab and they worm it out of you that you're in cinema, they're always still fond of going, well, it's in videos, isn't it? That's what's, you know, how are you doing against it? No, in videos. And you go, well, you know, we're still here, you know, one way or another. I think cinemas have improved, though, haven't they, you would have to say.
I would generally say they have. I mean, there was certainly a, I am of the age, so in my teens, they're doing all that kind of multiplexy thing and they're cutting up decent cinemas into, you know, bits and pieces, obviously. And so I remember them being, I remember the smell of that kind of weird styrofoamy, whatever it was. That was everywhere in cinema, and that was quite off-putting, even though the output in the 70s, which is when it was terrific, the sort of surroundings had lost all their glamour. So,
well, that, yeah, I mean, well, that's interesting, actually, because that sort of takes us into what we were going to talk about, which was 1970, which is the one you picked, because what I've got here is all the books. I mean, I can show you, the listener can't see it, but...
the legends. Oh, look at that. The... Very neat handwriting.
Yeah, that's my dad's handwriting, and obviously, and yeah, so I've got all these records, and it's just really interesting to see what sort of business they did and what sort of things people were going to see back then. But what were you saying about 1970? Oh yes, which was the sort of real start of the decline, wasn't it, in cinema, in cinema admissions, in people going to the cinema? And it's, you know, it was largely, why do you think that was? Was it because the films were rubbish, or the cinemas were rubbish, or was it both?
And television got better, you know, television got a lot better, and television then allowed people to talk over the back fence and all that kind of thing, before they had water coolers. So I suppose that was, I do remember that television became, I mean, you think about the kind of audiences, you know, double figure audiences, no problem at all in millions for television. So, but cinema was still, it was still, I think, especially for young people, there was still that chance of, you got away, didn't you? You got away to the cinema. And you could get.
I do regret never having that experience either sometimes, oddly. In the, you know, I never had to put big shoes on to get into the cinema to see it.
Oh, I know. And actually, during the 70s, I had one of my kind of humiliations. I think I was 14 and I had a boyfriend who was 17. And we wanted, yeah, and he wanted to take me to see Clute, which actually, frankly, at 14 would have been probably fairly, yeah, absolutely straight over the
straight over your head.
But, you know, I think I might have got something out of it. Also, very, very dark. I mean, literally very dark. You can hardly make out what's going on most of the time. But we went to the cinema and the woman said to me, how old are you? And I was 40, but I was young. I was tall, so I am not much. And I said, in one of those stupid panics, I'm 17. Which, I mean, if you're going to lie, why lie? 3 years is poor.
Yeah. You might as well, because was that was an exit, wasn't it?
So we got turned away from that, and then we had to get on a bus and go to another town, where actually we saw Stephen Frears' Gumshoe, which, you know, turns out to have been a really interesting thing to have seen at that time. Now, in retrospect, Albert Finney, really interesting film. But and I did quite enjoy it, but I couldn't really enjoy it because I knew I'd stopped us getting into Clute.
Because you lied by one year. Mm-hmm.
So now I always lie by more than 1 year.
But yeah, you go up rather than down. But that's, I mean, what would you, what would your 14-year-old self have made?
Oh, I have no idea. I think I would have been desperately looking for the romance in it. And looking and looking.
Not much of that. No, I mean, it
would have been, although I did like films that were somehow confusing and open-ended. I remember seeing Max Zoffel's Lola Montez on TV, because that's actually where I saw most of my films, was
Yes, of course. That, as we
and
did,
that
actually.
Was yeah. so strange, and it stuck with me. And occasionally I would see the old French film, French relatives and things, and the kind of open-endedness, the unresolvedness of that was something that I could find really fascinating. Even, but Clute, no, I don't think it would have honestly been at all. But
no, I sat through it again fairly recently, within the last 6 months, and it really holds up, I think,
yeah.
as a film. I mean, it's quite remarkable. And actually, quite a lot of the films that I've gone back to, like particularly from that period, you know, there's not much happens in them. You sort of you seem to remember there being a lot going on in it, and there is a lot going on, a lot of the subtext in it, but not very much right. happens in it.
There's quite a lot of people walking down, you know, walking through things. People walked in and out of buildings even more then than they do now. So films.
Yeah, but some of that, the way it was shot with that long, you know, a lot of long lenses, and it just looks absolutely fantastic. So, yeah, I'm not sure. My 14-year-old self, sadly, it's turned out to have been a disaster. I felt very sophisticated because that would have been 1977. Yeah. And we had I think most people in life had a groovy teacher. There was the groovy yeah. teacher that kind of opened your mind to other things. And he would get the school minibus out and take us places. He took me actually to my first concert, Frank Zappa, for God's sake. I mean, this is how groovy he was. And we went down to Brighton to see Annie Hall. I was 14. I know, and I thought it was the greatest thing I'd ever seen. It made me feel so sophisticated, and I've never understood. I mean, obviously, the way the world has gone, Woody Allen's rather out of favour at the moment, but I've never quite understood why that film affected me so much and why I became so enamored of it, because, you know, I'm I'm not from New York, I'm not Jewish, I didn't know one end of a woman from another, you know. What was it about that film that made me eschew it for Star Wars? You know, I eschewed Star Wars for Annie Hall. Ridiculous.
And have a favorite scene in Annie Hall?
Oh, my favourite scenes actually are, well, there's the one I refer to a lot, oddly, is the scene with the lobsters the second time.
When it doesn't
but it's
work.
The second time. When it doesn't work.
Absolutely. When he thinks, I'll try the old lobster on the new girlfriend. And you wait.
I relate to that so much. Wait, what? Are you joking? And actually, the warmth of the opening, where he does the, you know, sometimes I think I exaggerate my childhood memories, yeah. But we grew up on the roller coaster under Coney Island, and they talk to the camera, yeah. You know. Oh no, actually, no, you see that you've started me off now. Probably my favourite one is where, or one of my favourites is where he goes to the, his mother takes him to the doctor, and he's saying, you know. He's saying, one day the universe is going to end. He stopped doing his homework. What's the point? It made me feel, but maybe it just made me feel sophisticated.
Yeah, no, I absolutely loved it. I mean, I was already, I just got to college, was just going to college when it came out, and I saw, and then of course I dressed like that. Well, actually, everybody dressed like Diane Keaton when you're at college because you couldn't afford to. Everybody's on the thrift shop thing at the time. But it,
I don't know. This white middle class kid from Uckfield in Sussex, what did it say to me about anything at all?
I think it just says that fundamental thing about the way you think you're presenting yourself in the world and the way you're actually presenting yourself. Even you deep down know maybe there's a disparity between the two, and I think that's what's lovely about it.
And the second, I mean, rather like your flower experience with My Fair Lady, the second it started with that, him talking to camera, the way it just comes on, it seems so sophisticated to me. Two old ladies at a Catskill mountain resort, you know, all that kind of stuff. Anyway. So, what I did was, because I asked you to, I sent you this ridiculous list. Did you actually ever get
no,
to the
I
bottom
didn't.
Of it?
No, I didn't. Because it was because the 60s and 70s were so interesting. And kept thinking, oh, I've forgotten about that film, this film. And I was wondering, you know, I was wondering what the audiences would have felt like when they'd seen some of these things. And I was really intrigued to get into the kind of programming mind.
Well, so am I, actually, because, you know, I sort of remember snippets of conversation. So I was quite young at this point. So we're going to June 1970. And I would have been, seven going on eight. So I wasn't really party to any other particular conversations. What I do remember is that he was happier when we were taking money. That's kind of, so there were certain films that had, you know, gave him a warm, fuzzy feeling inside because they took money. That's my earliest memories.
Were you also aware that he was, that he had personal enthusiasms as well, that he wanted to get in there?
Well, yes, and at the same time, no, because one of the things that's different, very different between me and my father, is that he loved cinemas, and I love cinemas, but he loved, you know, seats and projectors and ticket machines and the machinations of running a cinema. That was his passion. That's what he loved to do. He'd started in the business in 1948 as a rewind boy in Eastbourne. And when you literally did, you know, one person's job to rewind the film. And he got out of the business for a few years. But even then, he was in guest houses. He bought a guest house with his mum in Eastbourne. And even then, he had to build a cinema in the basement for the guests for after dinner. So it was cinema. So he loves films. He loved films. But he wasn't into it in the way that you and I are into cinema. You know, it wasn't his thing. So his decisions were largely based on what he thought people would want to come and see, which is, you know, as I run a cinema now, mine are too, so this particular period, 90, so I had a disagreement actually with a famous critic person a few years ago on Twitter, I believe it was, when I said that the 70s were one of the worst periods of all time what I thought it was the one of the worst periods commercially, because a lot of these films that we have a memory of cinema or a memory of didn't really play out in the provinces.
I don't think Five Easy Pieces was probably pulling them in. All these masterpieces.
That's the thing. And actually what we were on the verge of at this point where you've chosen is this awful period of softcore pornography and television spin-offs through the, I mean, you know, Are You Being Served? And this is what we had to survive on in the 70s. So this kind of, and I, as I know you are, a passionate fan of 70s American cinema, but it didn't play. I mean, I looked back at Network and Taxi Driver, we were having single digit people, you know, six people, five people, four people. So, you know, the fact that they were such fantastic films, the fact that or the idea that people went to see them in droves is not true.
But this was when I was looking through those grids, this is June 1970, isn't it? So yes. I thought it was just a really interesting mixture. I mean, I would have been popping into it had I been old enough at the time and nearby.
Yes.
I wouldn't have been able to get into any of these films actually at that stage. But now, so you start off with, the interesting thing is that sometimes there will be maybe an 18 month or even a year's delay before you're shot.
Oh, well, that's the way, yes, no, and more sometimes. I mean, if we look at the Graduate and Thomas Crown double feature, I mean, they were already 2 years old. Some were even older. Because that's the way films were released. Firstly, there was no television really to you know, they weren't going on TV so quickly, or video, DVD didn't exist, and we had to wait for months sometimes, because a film would play 6 months in the West End or 3 months in the West End before it went out on general release. Then they would have things like a North London release and a South London release and then a Midlands release, and then, you know, because they only made 50 or 60 copies of a film. That's all they did back in those days. So it had to work its way around the country. And, you know, culture was different then, wasn't it? It wasn't, I have to see it now.
No, absolutely not. No, it would, no, quite. It was not. But it, and also, you wouldn't have been receiving, you know, something on your phone telling you how many stars something was giving you. You might have read Dillis Powell, or you might not, or whoever. It was not. No, you'd be quite happy with whatever was turning up.
Yeah, and also at that time we still had the barring system. Are you familiar with that? Well, that was a big thing all the way through, right up until about 1981 or two when it was made illegal. It was basically a bunch of gentlemen's agreements where one cinema would prevent another from playing. So, for instance, Uckfield, which is in the middle of East Sussex in the Weald, was barred by Lewis, which is 8 miles away to the south, and Crowborough, which is 8 miles away to the north. They both had cinemas at the time. So, stop me if this gets dull, but Lewis was barred by Brighton.
So it was a hierarchy.
Yeah, absolutely. And it was this kind of chain of events. And actually, that was one of my dad's things, was that he knew who barred everybody. So whenever you mentioned a town, he went, oh, yeah, they're barred by so-and-so and so-and-so. It was this incredible
network. Did they ever... I mean, was this done just on revenue-raising ability? I mean, or was there
No, it was just done on... It was just done on the fact that Odeon were more powerful than you were. ABC were more powerful than you were. And they wanted to protect the bigger cinema. So Brighton was protected. But... yes, so that whole 1970 April, May, June period there, yeah, I mean, crikey, you'd have a great time.
Oh, absolutely. No, well, you see, the first one I spotted was Love, Beast, Terror from 1968.
Yeah.
A good bit of... Now, you see, it didn't really matter how long after release that was. You would still go and see that kind of Peter Cushing horror film, entomologist whose Sunday. Daughter turns into a... by night turns into a giant moth.
I actually,
it's on YouTube. I had a little look last night.
Yeah, I had a peek, I have to say.
It starts off with one of those classic bits where they've got some, they've obviously bought in some footage of Africa, haven't they? And then they cut it into somebody in a canoe in the Norfolk Broads going, oh, it's got the most wonderful start. But apart from that, it is notable for, apart from the idea of the entomology idea, and that the father also makes a matching giant moth to be a companion for his daughter when she becomes a giant moth. But it's really nice, actually. You know, your dad had always done that. That would be great. But the daughter is played by that great actress, Wanda Ventum, whose mum is she?
I don't know. You've got me on that one. Go on. No.
Well, wow. In fact, she even appears in a later, she and his father appear in a later episode of Sherlock playing his parents.
Oh, wow. Yeah,
and if you look, well, look again on the trailer or on YouTube, you can see when you look at her, you can see.
Oh, wow. That's amazing. I mean, it was a company called Tygon Films, which I remember as a kid turning up all the time. They're sort of sub-Hammer, weren't they?
And you've got Peter Cushing in there. Everybody thinks, oh, what was his Hammer? But I have to say, in terms of pacing, shall we say, not really quite.
No, but they didn't care on a Sunday. They didn't care. That was the thing. It played on Sunday, June the 7th. And we had 119 people in. And it took, it took £29, 15 shillings and sixpence.
Great, but that's back in the time where I was, as a kid, that was something that early on with my friend Ali, we both loved horror. We just loved horror, and we would sort of read about all these kind of things. And if we'd had the chance to see Blood Beast Terror, then we would have done, because it was that thing where, you know, giant moth, if it had been that many years later and you were dealing with a sort of driller killer or something, then but the giant moth in the woods was sort of relatable and completely implausible.
And not really that horrific, was it? Let's face it. And that's what I remember, again, going back to what my dad used to say when I was around that age. He said that the Sunday one day was really important to him because it was the busiest day of the week. And so he would never have two Sundays the same, even if it was when Oliver came out and it was 14-day booking. No, it's got to be 13 days because I can't have two Sundays the same because it's so important to Sundays. So... Hang on, it played... Oh, it was a second feature with it. What was that? Oh, I've never heard of that one. Mission from a Kid. No,
that was
no
it. I think as far as I could make out, it was a sort of Euro pudding thriller. Yeah.
Was it? And again, it didn't really matter then. They just came along. And then 3 days, Monday, June the 8th, I Am Curious Yellow.
Swedish. Nudity.
I know, but I...
Swedish art house film, which was famous just for showing full frontal nudity. Lots of it. But again, did they see it? Did they go to it?
Yeah. So Monday we had 111 people in. I mean, this would have been one show. That's it. That's all he did once nightly. So that would have been an 8 o'clock show or 7 o'clock show. And we had 310 seats at the time. So that's not too bad. 111 people, £28, 16 shillings. Tuesday the 9th, 100 people. And on Wednesday the 10th, 89 people. So 300 people
that's
in 3 days.
That's pretty good.
It's not bad. And I tried to watch it. Oh, boy. It's a bit heavy, isn't it?
Really? It's full of ideas. It's full of, well, this is the whole thing, isn't it, about that sort of 60s and 70s European cinema, where the idea was, we're going to see this because you might get a flash of boob or you'll get whatever it is. But you usually had to sit through an awful lot of people with moustaches talking very, very seriously about, and in this, it's politics. It's everything, really. It's great sort of mishmash of ideas. And the nudity is just like, oh, well, happening. She's sort of freewheeling.
They were so sophisticated, these Europeans, weren't they? This must have been what the audiences would think. But presumably that the audiences weren't going along for the art house content.
No, of course they weren't. And they must have, you know, been really twiddling their thumbs or whatever. Obviously, I didn't see it at the time, but I did used to read newspapers. My parents used to get quite a lot of newspapers and I used to sit and read them. And I remember the notoriety of it. You see, and that's what would have brought you people in, I expect.
I think so. But, I mean, it's not a film that people remember fondly, and it's not a film that we go back to, really, is it? No. And Lord knows what the nude ones was.
Oh, I cannot imagine.
The second feature.
But I think somehow they might have delivered a little more value for money in this.
I think so, yeah. But it's fascinating, absolutely fascinating. It would be great to go. I'd love to go back and ask people coming out. So, how did you find that? Ooh, very strange. So, and then 3 days. So, this is what I mean. He was very good at this kind of thing, of sort of bolting a week together of this, that, and the other. And so he covered pretty much all bases, I think, here in this whole week. Because in those days we were Sunday to Saturday.
Right. Yeah.
That was the week. Films changed on a Saturday was the last night of the week. And then 3 days on The Graduate and The Thomas Crown Affair, sort of classic.
Yeah, which presumably this was mopping up. Well, there's people who might have possibly seen it when it first came out, or just mopping up those who'd never got to London to see it or wherever.
Possibly. Or did people go more than once to see a film?
And by then, Graduate had won Oscars, hadn't it? I think both Hoffman and Bancroft. Oh, I don't know. But they certainly get nominated. And I think Mike Nichols win something, so there's been lots of publicity around it, and
but going through the book, it turns up all the time for about the next 5 or 10 years. It's not that, oh well, yeah, there's a few people that haven't seen it. No, it keeps turning up, so people either, you know, they would come back and see it again, I'm assuming. I don't I don't know. So we had Thursday 100 people, Friday 125, and Saturday 180 people, 405 people. I know. I mean, there was, because I quickly looked at it. 1969 they came out.
Yeah.
Oh, no, 68. 1968.
Yeah, I think it was still in the States,
Yeah, so they were already 2 years old, and people were still coming. And The Graduate, I mean, who do you love The Graduate?
Oh, yeah,
who
doesn't love The Graduate? The Graduate, because it's so funny and so sad. So sad. but you know, terrifically funny at the same time. I know, because it's got that depth and that complexity.
Yeah. What's fascinating about it is that Hoffman was 30.
Yeah, he's only like 2 years, 3 years younger than Anne Bancroft.
And Thomas Crown Affair, which is kind of that's Norman
Jewison. Yes, that's
Norman
Jewison. Yes. Split screen and a song that wins it. Always a bad sign when the song wins the Oscar.
It's always a bad sign. Oh, no. But it's a bit hard going, I thought. I watched it about 6 months ago, and I have to say I drifted
off. When they remade it, when it was towards the end of the 90s or whatever, and people were saying, oh, how can you touch this classic? And then you go back and look and you go, actually, remake it.
Yeah, yeah. Somebody asked on Twitter the other day, remakes that are better than the original.
Mm. Yeah.
I think that might be one. And The Fly. That's the only one I could come up with. Although I have to say, would it be... No, oh, maybe this could be sacrilege if I say this, but I actually prefer... I'm going to say it out loud. Soderbergh's Solaris to Tarkovsky's. Is that
No, I think Soderbergh's Solaris is pretty good. I mean, they're sort of different, but I think it's really good.
It kind of gets to the point, doesn't it? I feel bad for saying it. But of course, the one I think, you know, that seemed to prick your interest the most, June 14th, 7 days, Women in
Yes, Love. Ken Russell, obviously. Glenda Jackson wins an Oscar for it. And she's as Gudrun of the two Brangwyn sisters in the Lawrence. Just terrific. I think it's so good. I mean, it's long. It's 2 hours.
It is long, isn't it? And do you think it goes slightly awry towards the end? I saw it. It
disappears off to foreign climes. And yeah, it turns into something else then, doesn't it? But early on, she's so good. Oliver Reed and Alan Bates, excellent.
I watched it not that long ago, a few months ago, and it still seems remarkably contemporary, actually. Even though it was a period piece at the time, obviously. Although there is the whiff of the 60s is unmistakable.
Yeah, definitely. Yes, and the manner of the disrobings and is all quite 60s, isn't it? And I think that it's because there's something quite gentle about Oliver Reed in it too, which is wonderful. Before you get to, you know, you're not expecting it in that character, and yet he's quite vulnerable. And you're going to lose some of that in later Oliver Reed performances. But at this stage, you're getting something interesting.
Yes, I think you're right, because he does his kind of sort of whispering acting thing that he does very well. But actually, he's the most, the way that the four of them are, they're kind of, in many ways, their relationship, particularly Glenda Jackson, Oliver Reed's relationship, is really interesting because it's kind of upside down from the norm, isn't it, in a way? She's the one that's confident and knows things, and he's the one that's hemmed in by tradition and by, you know, making sure the family business runs properly. And...
No. He's the kind of careful one in that sense. And she's absolutely the free spirit, and therefore it's sort of second wave feminism is coming along in a, you know, interesting already there in that. I like it a lot. I mean, I saw it again, five or 6 years ago, and was, actually it's a bit more than that, because it would have been, was it maybe just before Russell died, actually? So I went to see Glenda Jackson when she was still an MP, and she didn't want to talk about acting at all at that stage. But she made an exception to talk about this. She felt so strongly about it, and she also felt so strongly that Ken Russell was undervalued by the director.
Well, I think you're... Yes, I mean, why do we not revere him as much as we should? Why do we not...
Why do we not think The Devils is a great film? I mean...
they're all amazing. Yeah, well, not all of them, but...
but many of them are. And, you know, but people sort of... They hold on to the excessive parts, as though this was somehow all that he did. And for example, the Devils, which apart from the German designs and the generally the ambition of it all, and again, Reed quite kind of dialed down in the performance. Everybody remembers the orgy scene, you know, the nuns and the crucifixes and all that, which in fact is a smallish part of it and really doesn't dominate the action in any way whatsoever, but was again the thing that received all the coverage. I don't know that the imagination of him, it's very, very sad indeed, I think.
He never lived down that sort of enfant terrible thing, did he? People would insist on calling him that, even in his 80s, I think.
I know. And I mean, I went to see him not long before he died to talk about the boyfriend, because I think it was an anniversary of the boyfriend. And you couldn't get hold of the boyfriend. The boyfriend wasn't on...
No, you can't.
And I found a VHS copy and I took it down and we watched it together, and he was, oh, I know, and he was going, oh, look at this, and he said, oh, I haven't seen this in ages. And it was just so wrong that this very distinctive British talent was not being recognised in any way.
Well, going back to my disagreement with this other person in the 70s, I was trying to think British cinema in the 70s. I think that was my point. It wasn't that 70s cinema was not good, to be fair. It was more about British cinema, and the 70s was appalling. And the only two people coming up with anything interesting in the 70s were Nick Rogue and Ken Russell, really.
Yeah.
I mean, they flew the flag for anything that was interesting and different and groundbreaking, really. But Nick Rogue's reputation seems to remain high. But Ken Russell, not quite the same. I mean, I suppose his films were often difficult, even in that period, weren't they? Listomania,
quite tricky. I know.
Tommy, I adore Tommy. I can watch that any time. I think it's an extraordinary film. But The Devils is definitely his thing. But is his masterpiece, I think. Because Women in Love is a different thing, isn't it?
It is. Yeah, if you want more the kind of the essence, as it were, insofar as we can define it, of Russell, then I think maybe it is Devils. There are moments in Music Lovers, but it's a little bit too hysterical for me.
I always enjoyed the Music Lovers a lot. Again, I think as a teenager, it was all that. It was just its verve. It was like, at the risk of sounding really really trite, it was kind of punk cinema, wasn't it? Before punk was invented, in a way. You know, it was. And the fact that they gave him the money to do it is quite extraordinary, really. But he was going to the end, wasn't he?
Oh, and making, you know, just getting a few friends around with, and the house. I mean, I went to his last two houses, and they always had lots of, you know, masses of props and bits and pieces just ready to do some kind of strange exorcism in the back garden or whatever it was that you need to film next.
So, okay, so that's Women in Love, which we can recommend people go back and look at. And the people of Uckfield definitely thought so. I mean, just having a quick squiz very quickly around it. 100 Rifles the following week. Spring and Port Wine.
James Mason.
Watched it only 3 weeks ago. It was on the wonderful Talking Pictures. I don't know whether you ever tune into that channel. Yeah, it's James Mason, Rodney Bewes, Susan George. The mother, I always forget her name. She was in Father, Dear Father. That's a mum from Father, Dear Father. Not Father, Dear Father. Bless His House. With, what was her name? I can't remember her name. I know. But that was interesting. Yes, that was very interesting. I mean, actually, we could do this all day, to be honest. So I should let you go, really.
Lovely thanks for this. Taken into your family. What did it look like in 1970?
Well, now here's the thing. We do not have a picture of the inside. And I think, why is that? Because people didn't take pictures, did they, in the same way they do now? I can close my eyes and see it, but that's no help to anybody, is it? So it was one screen, and it was a balcony, not a circle, a balcony, which is a sort of raised bit at the back, and the stalls. And I can see it. It absolutely, and a tiny foyer, smaller than we've got now. And we had no toilets. Well, we had one lady's toilet, and the gents was outside, round to the left and up the end of the passage. That was one of the phrases I grew up with. Where's the bog, mate? Oh, it's outside, round to the left and up the end of the passage. One of the first, probably almost my first words. Because it had been built, you know, 1916, right in the middle of the First World War. So I wish I had a picture. If there's anybody out there in the world that has a picture of the interior of the Picture House Uckfield before it was twinned or made into two screens in 1977, I'd love to have it. But we can't find one anywhere. And we did a lot of digging, but we can't find one.
I will send one to you. Somebody send one in. I'd love to have it.
Yeah, no, that'd be great. All right, then. Well, I should let you go because I can... Well, so can you actually talk for England, if we're honest. No, I really appreciate it.
Absolute
thank you.
Pleasure.
So, a very big thank you to Francine for taking the time out to talk to me. I know she's pretty busy at the moment writing a new novel. So I really appreciate her time. Thank you very, very much. And thank you for listening. What I should point out that we didn't mention in the chat was how well Women in Love actually did in the end. It played 7 days, Sunday, June the 14th, and took actually pretty good, £291 and 19 shillings. Fairly healthy admissions, 147 on the Sunday, 132, 178, 187, 142. So, and on the Saturday, actually 204 admissions. So very healthy business indeed. And in those days, there was no such thing as a holdover. You didn't think, oh, that's doing well, I'll go a second week, because that's not how things were done. So I hope you've enjoyed this. Next time, I believe Neil Brand will be my guest. And we're going to be talking about Close Encounters of the Third Kind, mostly, and also about the cinemas, the local cinemas he used to frequent when he was living in Burgess Hill. So please do join me next time. I hope you've enjoyed this. Get in touch at Kevin Markwick on Twitter, or you can email me at podcast@picturehouseupfield.com with any questions. Let me know how you think the show is going, and hopefully we'll see you next time. Thanks. Bye.